this talk is going to be on something that I love, which is reinforcement learning. And about 10 years ago, I went back to graduate school for artificial intelligence, and I learned about RL there, and it is not, unfortunately, it's a little embarrassing to say, it's not an exaggeration to say that it's like changed my life. So I think about almost every single problem that we face as a reinforcement learning problem, and as anyone who knows me knows, I'm always talking about it. So this isn't just something like I wanted to like bring up, it's like I think it's really important, I believe it's really important, and I think it's going to be super useful for everybody. That's my take. I'm also like way out here on Michael's conflict scale, so I'm totally psyched if you think this is stupid or you want to like argue with me. I'm ready to do that, and that won't offend me at all. I'll love it. So as you guys know, AI has been in the news a lot. It's like a thing, and even actually just 2 days ago, I believe, there was this big advance. There was a poker AI that just beat the top four, or some of the top four poker players in the world. And that just happened 2 days ago, and what was kind of interesting about that is that poker was always kind of considered to be a hard problem for AI, and it just beat these four poker players. So this is AI, what is it? And currently, it's often a black box for a lot of people, and I think that came out on our panel, to whomever was here on Tuesday. We had a panel about machine learning and AI. And my sense was that there was a fair amount of uncertainty about like what we're even talking about. And it's just like this thing that just kind of exists out there. And I personally think it's really helpful just to have a basic idea of what something is, and then you can feel more comfortable with it. And then you can decide if you want to go and learn more about it or not. So today is the day that we're looking in the box. So we're going to like open it up. I'm going to unpack some stuff from AI. And what's going to be in it for you is that we're going to talk about RL. And RL is going to be a good framework for integrating, or how you think about A/B testing. Attribution. So usually when people talk about attribution, it's like, I don't even really know what it is. I would argue often it's probably maybe not that useful in how it's currently thought of, but you have your own experiences. And also predictive targeting. So these are all going to be components of like one thing, reinforcement learning. And so then you can like see how everything fits together. And I think that's super powerful, whether or not you actually implement it or not. It'll help you when someone comes in and wants to sell you something, or you're talking about it within the industry. This is going to give you a good framework for it. We're actually going to talk about and walk through an actual example and method from artificial intelligence, right? So you're going to learn, you're going to walk out of here today knowing a method from AI. So that is something you'll be able to go back and like, well, I know AI, and that will be true, sort of. Also, this could be, it's late before lunch, and I kind of have like a monotone nasally voice, so it gets a little fatiguing, and we're going to go into a little detail. So to keep you paying attention, I have some bottles of whiskey that will be given away as prizes at the end, and in order to get a bottle, you're going to have to answer a question. So, right, that's right, whiskey, that's right. So, but the question is going to be about the, you have to answer it correctly, based upon my assessment, and it's going to be about the talk, or content about the talk. So what is reinforcement learning? It's not a method, right? It's not a solution. It's not like a particular thing. It's actually a problem. So it's like, do we have a reinforcement learning problem, or is our problem amenable to be thought of as a reinforcement learning problem? So we'll talk about what that is. And what it is we are trying to learn learn a sequence of decisions. So it's a thing, it's a type of problem we're making sequences of decisions. And in order to learn, we actually have to interact with the environment. So we have to learn by trial and error, right? So most of the time when people are talking about machine learning or predictive modeling, whenever you say like the data, which I hate, that drives me crazy because you don't have the data, right? You may have some old data, or you may not have the data, But you have a new problem that you're trying to solve, so you don't have the answer to it, and it means you probably don't have the data. So you kind of have to collect it, and the way to collect it is via trial and error, and I'll talk about one version of trial and error learning that everyone knows about, and then we'll build from there. And then we're ultimately trying to achieve some sort of goal, right? So as an example, if I can get this to work. Okay, so this is AI, this is Google's DeepMind, and this is it playing Breakout. This is an old Atari game, Atari 2600. And so Google's DeepMind has been doing a lot of work, and we see at first the game is pretty crap because it hasn't learned how to play the game. But notice, there was no data originally. What it's doing is it's playing the game, it's getting feedback, and then it's improving how it's playing, right? And it has to make decisions about where to be that are kind of over time. It's not like a one-off thing. And so over time, what this game is learning is a strategy. So after only 600 episodes, it's learned a strategy that it wants to try to get the ball up through the edges. So you can have that really somewhat oddly satisfying experience of having the ball up in that top and doing that, and just like blurring. So it learns that, and it has to learn it not by like having loads of data, collecting loads of data, and then after the fact learning about it. It learns it iteratively, and it's interacting with the world. And this type of learning is reinforcement learning, and this is exactly kind of how we learn in the world, right? So this is not conceptually complicated, which is why I love it, because I don't really get the really complicated stuff. And I'm going to make the argument that reinforcement learning is the problem that we solve when we're doing optimization, and I'm not talking like metaphorically. Right? I'm not saying it's kind of like that, you can think of it that way. I'm actually saying it is that. Right? I'm making a strong statement. I'm going to argue that the same solution, the same problem, or the same approach that they're taking to solve those video games, one of those AIs, is the exact same approach that we should be taking, at least conceptually, when we're thinking about optimizing, say, our website, or a call center, or across that. We're talking about multi-touch optimization, which means we're learning over sequences, right? The user can transition from place to place, and we have to make decisions from place to place. And what's nice about this is, as you'll see, you'll have to visualize the complexity of it. So it may be, what's useful about this is you may realize that actually, you know, really now that we know how to solve these types of things, the domain of our problem or the nature of our environment or, you know, the scale of it is such that this probably isn't going to work for us, right? So it's helpful in both ways. It's helpful for you to actually utilize it, but it's also very helpful for you to, like, evaluate. And I think that's the main value of the analyst is not necessarily application of a solution. Usually simple solution is all you want. But it's really the complexity and thinking about all the complexities of the problem and properly defining the problem. So I'd way rather a much better defined problem and an approximate solution than like an awesome solution that is being applied to not really the right problem. So I'm not going to really talk about tools or anything. We're just going to talk about concepts. But I think it's worthwhile. So just so you know that this isn't like me making this up and it's this like Gershoff's thing. This is DeepMind, so it has to be Google, so everyone feels comfortable that's real. It's Google is here. And this is a paper, and now I can't prove it because it's chopping up. It's saying up here, learning to play Atari with deep reinforcement learning. So you actually do have to take my word on it. But within it, you see, is this cue learning. Right? And cue learning is a method, is a particular solution to solve reinforcement learning problems, to solve learning over sequences or multi-touch decisions. This is an actual method, and we're going to walk through this in detail. So this is what you're going to know. It's like, oh, deep mind, oh, that's just cue learning. I got that. I mean, I went to Superweek. So we're going to first talk about something simple so we have a base to build on, and we're going to talk about A-B testing and A-B testing as an example of trial and error learning, right? So we have, this is stuff you know. Single location, right? So that's our decision point. That's where we're going to be making our decision. We want to figure out, well, what hero? That's our decision. And then we have a couple of options. So we're going to decide between competing options. The user comes in. We have to make a decision. We don't really know, so we're just going to try one out. So we're going to pick the fancy version, right? I think for me, and I think in general, it's useful, you know, because usually it's just like A-B testing, and you're just thinking about p-values, or in your mind, you're arguing between Bayesian or frequentist argument nonsense, which is not particularly useful to think about the problem. For me, it's useful to think about it graphically and just like, what are the flows that are actually happening, and how do we map out the problem? So just abstractly, we have a location, we have a decision. You could have, you know, any number of options here, and this could be a compound decision, right? Could be like a multivariate test. But the point is it's taking place one place in time. That's key. Time is key, location is key. What can the user do? Well, we can play A and they can convert. We could play B and they can convert. We could play A and they could not convert. And then we could play B and not convert. That's it. Like, it's pretty simple, right? There's only really four bits that you need to do in this simple type of test. But this is like A-B testing. How do we solve it? We can solve it with A-B testing, right? We can also solve it with multi-armed bandits. So multi-armed bandits, A-B testing kind of sit in the same class in this way of thinking about it, which is they are both approaches of learning trial and error, right? You have to interact with the environment. Now, I know for some reason there's some controversy about multi-armed bandits. Krista's coming up afterwards, and she's gonna talk about their product and slag off bandits or whatever. But since this is my talk, I'm right in this case. And it's not one or the other, though. It's really, again, it gets back to problem definition. What is the problem we're trying to solve, right? And once you know what the problem is in detail, you can assess whether or not we want to, like, randomly collect the data and do, like, an A-B test, or do we want to think of it more as a bandit and do something where we're factoring in the cost of learning. But I would agree, the multi-armed bandit is like not like some panacea thing. None of this is. That's the main thing. There is no one thing. So this is it. Like, it's really simple, and there's a real low sort of cognitive and computational load that you need to solve this type of problem, right? Because it's at one point. And so we only need like some tabular or numerical representation of like the conversion value, right? We might also need variance and whatever, but it's just in this scope. So we're going to talk a lot more about attribution. I'm not like a big attribution guy, like as it's currently practiced, but I'm not an expert in it. So maybe people have a lot of expertise in it. To me, it doesn't really make any sense if you're not doing anything at each of those points. Then it's just like you just have an existing process, and whatever you're learning is just a shadow of that, and so you don't know how it's going to respond if you change it. So the whole point is we want to make a change in the environment and see how the environment responds back to improve our value. So what is nice about RL is that it's going to let us couple together ideas from A-B testing, which is experimentation and really a control problem, with attribution, right? So that's what's going to be powerful here, what I think you could make it useful in the right domain. So what do I mean, right? We have homepage, as we have before. We have a decision. A couple decisions come in. Could be multivariate, but it's happening on one page. It's happening or one spot. You know, this could be the email, or this could be the call center. It doesn't really matter where. It's just that it's happening at once. And then we're making some decisions. And so this is still at a single location. It's more than one decision, but it is not. There's no attribution here, right? Because we're not taking place. We're not making decisions over time. But what if we are, right? And how is that going to change our little graph? So now we have two decision points. I put pages here, but again, it's really any transactional system. It doesn't have we don't have to think about websites anymore. We can think about some sort of device. We can think about mobile apps. We can think about call center. Any transactional system that's making decisions and has a transactional call to action is the same problem, okay? And with APIs and whatnot, that's one advantage of using a headless system, is that you're not forced to interface with a GUI tool, and that usually means you're thinking about just the web page. So just like A-B testing, what can you do? If I play A or B, they could leave, we could lose them, they could not convert, they could exit the site. Or, awesome, they converted, we're psyched. So this little subgraph, that's A-B testing, that's just what we saw before, we're all totally familiar with that. But changes a bit now that we have another decision point. And only one extra point adds to this complexity, because now in red, what we have here are kind of the dynamics of the system. Because what can happen? I can either not convert and I could leave the site or the system. I could convert, and or I can wind up transitioning to page two. So I've actually like sent the user over to another point in the process, another touch point. And so we're going to want to have to factor that in to what the value is of playing A or B, because there's a whole system here, and we're going to have to account for that. And these red lines are the attribution lines, right? This is the attribution problem. It's like, how do we kind of solve the fact that users can flow around? And this, by the same token, they could come in page two first. And so you see, like, the red side is the additional complexity that we have, because now we have two different decision points. And the blue is the stuff that we're familiar with. And what we're going to need to do is we're going to have some framework or some method of analyzing these in the same scope or at the same time, right? Is that clear? I mean, I feel like this is like super obvious, but it's, you know, it adds. It's not obvious. So, right? Just like, but okay, just go back. A/B testing. Right? I'm either doing A or B, and the user can either convert or not convert, right? And then the same thing could happen if I have another test running, but if the user, if they're all both working towards the same goal or goals, the user could also wind up on another test. So I mean, how do I assess the value of that? That's probably going to affect the conversion rate. So, and anyway, this might help you think about whether you want to do attribution or not as well, because it implicitly is this complexity behind it. So conversion rates, we got that. That's just our normal reporting, our normal A-B testing, right? But here, I have to calculate conversion rates for both the test that I'm doing on page one and the test on page two, right? So I'm playing either A or B on page one or C or D on page two. And they have totally different conversion rates. But now there's this other thing. And this is the hassle thing. And this is the transition frequencies or the transition probabilities. This is like, well, once we make a decision for a user, we give a user a particular experience, do they wind up converting or do they wind up going somewhere else within our multi-touch system, right? And so we're going to have to learn that too. And this is kind of the, what I'm going to show you though is like a trick that's super, I know it sounds like it's going to be really complicated, but it's like magic. And I hate saying magic when we're talking about analytics or data science, but when I realized it, it just totally blew me away. So, but right now, and when people are doing normal attribution, it's like this type of thing, complicated. I think it's complicated. So, how is like Google? How do most people do attribution, right? It's usually like this backward calculation, and that's normally how most analytics is. It's like we wait for everything to happen, and then we kind of like go back and try to see what caused it, right? So that's usually like the user comes in, right? They get an experience. Maybe they transition over to like the special offers page. We make another decision for them. They come to the search results, right? And then they sign up. Awesome. But then we want to figure out, well, how do we attribute the impact of each one of these things? Because ostensibly, all of them potentially have contributed to this person finally taking the action that we wanted to. So the agent has to say, okay, we got $20 for this thing, and now there's gotta be some way to apportion this goodness back. So that everyone knows that they have some, each decision needs signal to tell it what it should do. I'm trying to pick between A or B, you gotta give me something, right? You've gotta like credit them as a signal for them to make the right decision, right? This is Google, right? Little reference point. And this is, I think, I don't know if this is old or not. Sorry, Google guys, if this is like the old display from your attribution-y thing. And I don't know if this is the free or the premier one. But these are like the different methods that they have for assigning the value back in that slide before, right? And it's that problem. But it's all backwards. I don't mean backwards, but it's backwards thinking. I'm interested in time delay, so we're gonna talk about our method is gonna use the time decay, so it's gonna be like roughly the same thing. And the question is this the only way? Is the collecting the data and then trying to assign the credit after the fact the only way to do it? Obviously, no, there is another way, right? And this, you should get really excited right now. I know you don't, I'm not feeling the excitement because this is so huge. That's right. This is huge. At least to me, it's huge. Okay, so just going back to this, just as a reference point, but you're going to brace yourself, right? Did I get that right? I'm so old now, I never get the memes right, but I think this is like the brace yourself one. Winter's coming, because we're going into this paper. We're going into, and this is like top research on AI. That's 2 years old now, so I guess it's a little old, but. So, here it comes. Okay. This is Q learning. This is the Bellman equation. You got to get your money's worth. We got one slide of math in here. Don't worry about it if you don't get it. Or if there's some of the other geeky folks in here. They got this. And they're going to go back and learn up on it. But we're going to recast this. We're going to interpret this after the next 8 slides or which will feel like 100. But this is going to get recast into the exact same vocabulary and ideas that we already have in web analytics. I promise you that. So we don't even really have to worry about it, but I want to put this out here. So this is terrifying, because now we've looked into the box, and you're like, oh my god, what is that? And it is pretty complicated, actually. But it's actually awesome. I'm going to show you how it's awesome. So this is what we're going to learn. We're going to learn that we're going to treat landing at another page or decision point in our process, in our attribution process, we're going to be able to treat it almost exactly like a regular conversion event, which you already do now. You guys already track goals and you assign it to the different treatments or experiences. And we're going to use a trick that's going to let us just do exactly the same thing. So conceptually, it's going to be very similar, and just mechanically, it'll be very similar, which to me is incredible. And the trick is that what we're going to do is we're going to use a future view, and we're going to make predictions. We're going to use predicted values, and we're going to say, hey, the user was here, we made a decision, and now they're over there, right? And then we can say from here, well, what's it worth to us to have them over there, right? So just like in a sales funnel, you know that when the user is very close towards the end of the sales funnel, they're worth more. They have a higher probability of converting. So it's like a better lead. So you'd be willing to pay more for them, right? It's the same type of thing. We have some sort of prediction about how good or how much value there is to having someone at one of these points. So it's like a future view. So I'm gonna like totally ride this graphic to death, but we're gonna take an action, so we're just gonna pick A, right? And then measure what, this is what we love here, is to measure what they do after, so we do A. And do they convert? Yes, awesome, that's totally great. That's 10 bucks, 10 euro. I just as a map here, if you wanna look back at it later, but we're going to set the R part of this, which is just a conversion event. Just think in your mind, just if you don't want to look at that equation, it's just a regular conversion event like we normally have. And it's worth 10 bucks, 10 euro or whatever. So far, we have not done anything different from A-B testing, what we're familiar with. And we're calculating it exactly the same. Now, a little tricky. Do they go to the next page? Either whether they see the goal or not, do they ultimately hit the next page? They do. It's a little more complicated. So we're going to have to like consider that, right? Because they could go on and do more stuff from page 2. It might be worth it for us to have them go to page 2. might be worth more than $10 even to have them go to page two. If it's a car sales site, and the $10 goal was like some referrer fee or something to send them off to somewhere else, maybe really we want them to go to page two so we can sell them on Kia Ceo, what was that? Like 10 years ago over here in Europe was like almost 40 grand. It's expensive, cars are expensive over here. Anyway, so we're now in the dynamic part of the path. So this is different. And now we're in attribution land. We're in the dynamics of it. But still it's not really, it doesn't look really that much different because in a way it really isn't. And this is where the trick is. I'm gonna pull the rabbit out of the hat. So we were on page, the user has now landed on page two, or the second place where we have to make a decision. They're there now. So we know they're there. So we know that we made a decision for them, we know they converted, and now we know that they landed somewhere else. And that's all we're gonna need to know. And we say, okay, well we have another decision there and we have two different decisions that we could make. We could do C or D, right? And we've been running this for a while, so we have some expected estimate of what each one is worth currently, right? I just made an extreme example. So it's either $1 or $5. So the way this is gonna work is we're gonna say, okay, they're there. And in the best case situation, I know if I play maximally, we're gonna get a predicted value of $5. Because on average, using D, giving the D experience on page two has yielded $5 in the past. So we're gonna predict that having the user wind up there is worth $5, right? So it's, we're using predictions. This could be noisy, and at first it is totally noisy, just like when you're running a test, stuff is totally noisy and they're not good estimates. But as we iterate and run this over and over, we'll start to converge to the right answers. Little technical detail, you can kind of not worry too much about this, but we do have like the discount rate, but to link it back into to Google Analytics land, really the discount rate is tightly coupled to Google's half-life when they're doing their decay. So it's the same thing, it's just a different representation of it. So I think if you typed in 7-day half-life, it's equivalent to roughly a 0.09% discount rate. It's like a rate between 0 and 9. This is like how we discount the future, right? And it's like related when you're doing your finances or not. Do they still have this? Is this part of Google Analytics still, like the attribution stuff? Am I making references to stuff that is completely not of interest to anyone? Anyway, Google does it, so it's okay. So now we have two values. We have our explicit goal, which was just like what we did in A-B testing, and now we have like this magic goal, conversion, which was we landed somewhere else. And so we'll just apply the discount rate. And so now we have the direct credit, which is what we're familiar with. And now we have this new type of credit, which is the attribution credit, which we've calculated, again, with our predicted values about landing at the next step. And now we're done. We have our total credit for playing A on page one, and then we just add that 5.5, however you either average it in or there's actually update functions, but you're basically saying for this particular experience, we got on average, we got 5.5 worth of credit for this. Maybe you're confused, so we'll wrap it up. And I'm gonna be around too, but it's like, it really is that simple. It really is two goals. One goal is the regular goal, and the other goals are landing in other places in your decision process. So there's two steps. Again, we just treat landing at another point in the decision process as a regular conversion. And then we just use predictions about the value of landing there as the conversion value. And there are nice properties, but actually that's guaranteed to converge, right? Because this is like a bootstrap method, the optimal result. And this is the method. What's amazing is like this simple method is kind of the kernel of what's being used for all the game playing AI over at DeepMind. I mean, obviously there's more advanced extensions to it, and I won't go into all the detail, but just that very key idea, is what's driving a lot of AI research. So that, like this, that's AI. So when we're talking about machine learning before an AI and people are like getting, oh, it's freaking me out. At the core, a lot of it is like nothing really. It's not really that impressive. But it is powerful when it's done at scale. So now you can be all blasé blah when someone talks about AI, you're like, yeah, whatever. One of the key things is that we want to usually include targeting because a lot of the value is conditioned on the attributes of the user or the user experience. Because remember, we're trying to assign an experience to different users, and so they'll respond differently. Just like Michael will respond differently to conflict and I'll respond differently. It's good to know who you're speaking with. So, targeting, very simple. It's just a rule. We just want to map users to experiences, customers to experiences, just a logic. Our favorite little framework. So we have a new user and they're from a rural area. So we're going to keep it really simple. So they have two attributes about them and we want to make a decision. So they land on page one and we give them A. And then there's no goal, there's just this transition. So we've given them A and now they've landed at page two. And now we're like, well, we know all we need to do is just treat landing at page two as a goal, and now we have to figure out what the value is of it. So it's going to depend on knowing that they're rural and a new visitor. So this is just like a screenshot from our product, and our system generates, we build decision trees off of our predictive model, so it's pretty easy to interpret. So are they rural or not? Yes or no? Oh, well, yeah, he or she is rural. And are they, now that we're at this node, are they a new user or not? Oh, yeah, they are. Okay, this person is in audience two. And then we go into the audiences, and then we see for each one of the audiences, which are just the outputs of the model, decision model, we have the predicted value of taking each of the actions conditioned on the attributes that they have, as well as the probability that it's the best. So this is very similar to the folks, so people say that I slag up. Tim's always saying that I'm always busting on Bayesian, but I totally don't. This is very similar to what you would do like in Bayesian A-B testing. We're really just using it for model building and for the output and estimation. So you get the predictive value as well as the probability. So we're just going to go to audience two because that's the one that matches. And then we see, B has the highest predicted value, right? And it's roughly 43% conversion rate. So given that it's a new enrolled visitor, if we were to play the maximum policy, right now we think it's around 43%. Now you might be thinking, well, it could be noisy, and there are other tricks of sort of doing averages over this and whatnot. But the most simple implementation, and this is the implementation, this max version of it, is what is used at DeepMinds in their program. So we now have the predicted value, what's neat is like the predicted value is based on a user, a particular user. And so we can say for this user, when we did A, and now we think that handing over the user to the second point, decision point, like a lead almost, is like worth, well, this guy or this gal is worth 40.43 times whatever the conversion rate is. So I have a use case before we wrap up really quick. We had a client, they had both marketing websites, so they were actually like an agency essentially, and they host marketing websites for their clients, a lot of cable companies and whatnot. They also have their own call centers. And so for them, it's pretty easy to stitch the website behavior back to the call center, right? So they have unique 800 numbers on the website that live for, they get assigned to a session and they live for a certain amount of time, like a month or so. And so what they wanted to do, they said, hey, look, kind of interested in this, but our conversion event is like at the call center. And what we really kind of wanted to do was link up making tests, improving, optimizing the website. But ultimately, there's this downstream conversion event, right? So this is kind of sitting nicely with our framework, which is we have like this delayed goal, which is going to occur down a process. But also they were like, well, when users come in, there's the IVRs, which are the automated voice systems, like what you get, and maybe they want to put like an ad in that while they're waiting or how they route them. And if you think about it, that like the IVR and the selection of the IVR is exactly the same problem as doing optimization on a website, right? It's like no different. It's like you have this transactional system which is trying to make a decision for users on what experience, and what IVR prompt was the experience. So the user would come in, and based upon attributes of the user, we would make decisions for them on the website. They would transition to the IVR in the call center, and then based on the close rate from the sales agent is what fed this whole system. And you know, whatever, there was some increase in conversion rate. Take that or leave it. I never believe any results when people are telling me results on up here as well, but it was a positive result. And so the way it worked, again, the user, she came to the website. A request came to us. We responded based upon the user features on what the response should be. Then the user, if we were fortunate, transitioned to the IVR. So this is our change of place. Oh, I'm sorry, I keep hitting this thing. The IVR calls the API, our API, and then we respond. Oh my God. Responds back to the IVR, to telling it what experience it should give the user. Hopefully the user then transitions to the sales agent, and then we make a sale, right? And then that gets driven in. And the way this works, you can almost think of this, another way of looking at it is like peer-to-peer optimization. So a user comes into the first touch point, optimization point. A request is made to the system. There's a local model, which is making predictions about the value of each experience for that user, right? Scoped to this one decision point, like that tree I showed you before. It responds back, well, what experience the user should get. The user then transitions over touch points to another decision point. The same thing happens. But then when the user makes a request for the decision at the second touch point does two things. The optimizer, one, sends a response back, but two, it calculates a predicted value. The same types of values it's using to make a selection, by the way, right? Because it's like, oh, this is the best predicted value for this user, this option, so I'm going to give it to this user. I'm also going to bundle up that number, and I'm going to pass it back as a goal reward to the first optimizer. And it's this little message passing thing, which, again, is just like a goal, which is the same thing we talked about before, is what keeps all of the local decision makers in harmony. Like, it's a way of kind of locally having local models that are globally harmonious, and they're solving like the global problem. So, what should you take away? One, attribution can be solved essentially by hacking, as much as I hate that term, but really we're kind of hacking A-B testing, right? We're hacking A-B testing by having this additional goal. Two, we also learned that we can extend the ideas of attribution to experiments in A-B testing. And actually, I think that's probably when you should be using attribution anyway. Three, you know, we've looked at some AI, and I know it feels totally not impressive, really, but actually it is pretty impressive, and it is the same types of algorithms that are being used in a lot of those news clippings when they're talking about the effectiveness of AI. So that is it. I think it was fairly quick.
Okay, enjoy your lunch. We will be back here at 2:20 in the afternoon, 1 hour or less, 53 minutes. Please be back here on time for Krista's item. She won't be waiting. She'll be starting exactly at 2:20. We have 53 minutes for lunch. Woohoo! Music, man. Music! Lunch! Hey, food!